and speak through these lips of clay to the waiting people. In the great unseen radio audience, I cannot see them, but dear Lord God, thou dost see them. Thou dost know who they are and where they are and what they need. Direct us in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul closes out chapter 2 by saying, we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity. Now, Paul was the most sincere person, I guess, that ever lived apart from Jesus Christ. He said, in the sight of God speak we in Christ. Everything that Paul preached centered around the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything he did, everywhere he went, he was centered in Jesus Christ in everything. And he preached Jesus dead, buried, risen, ascended, and coming again. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you or letters of commendation from you? Now, Paul is using just a little bit of irony or sarcasm. Paul said, do you need to write me and tell me how good you are? Do I need to write you and tell you how good I am? Listen, beloved, here's the thing that I cannot understand. And I'm sure that some of the dear people are listening today. I guess I received 25 letters during the time that I was preaching on 1 Corinthians. I know I didn't receive over 25 telling me never to send them another book. They did not intend to ever listen to me again. And one dear person had been writing to me for 5 years and sending $1 a week, every 2 weeks or a month. This person who had been writing to me for 5 years wrote me after 1 Corinthians and said, Mr. Green, I'll never write you again. I'll never support you again. I'll never listen to you again. Well, now the reflection is not on me. Any person who will listen to a minister 5 years and not discover that he's a false prophet, and then all of a sudden declare that he is a false prophet, the reflection is not on the preacher, it's on the listener. Now, you cannot deceive born-again believers. You cannot. If you're saved, you know whether I'm preaching the gospel or not. And a preacher who must continually tell his ministers that he's God's preacher, His people are not saved, or either the preacher's not saved. Now, what am I saying? Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect and precious, and he that believeth on him, Jesus, shall not be confused or confounded. Now, you absolutely cannot lead a born-again believer into liberalism or modernism. If they've ever been born again, they'll never become a liberal or a modernist. A born-again believer will never deny the fundamentals of the faith. Don't you ever think they will. Now, Paul said, do we need epistles of commendation from you? And do I need to write epistles to you? Ye are our epistle written in our hearts and known and read of all men. Every true believer is a living example of God's grace, a living epistle. And the things you do, the things you say, the places you go, the company you keep will testify whether or not you're saved. Light cannot commune with darkness, an idol cannot commune with Christ, and a believer cannot commune with an infidel. A born-again, blood-washed believer does not need to put a sign on your back. A born-again, blood-washed believer does not need to step out in the yard and announce to the neighbors, I'm saved. They'll find it out. You don't need to announce it. You will announce it in your living, not in an epistle. Verse 3, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And such trust have we through Christ to Godward. Now, these men who had corrupted the word of God in Corinth, and these legalizers and those who were deviating from the word of God and preaching another gospel, were advocating that you could be saved by grace, but you must live by the law and keep the law and follow the rituals of Judaism and so on. Look at verse 5. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is in God. Now, in Jesus Christ, we have every need supplied. My God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And in God, our sufficiency is, and we are not sufficient in ourselves. Let him that thinketh he stand take heed lest he fall. But there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful. It is God. If God be for us, who can be against us? Who shall be anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. And so God is our sufficiency. And it's not in the flesh. It is not by works of righteousness which we have done. But it is according to his mercy and his keeping power that we live and move and have our being and serve God. Who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth. The letter killeth. Read Romans 7. Read Romans 7, all of it. The letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. But if the ministration of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit rather be glorious? Now, it hasn't been but a very, very short while ago. I was traveling and I heard on my automobile radio as I traveled, I heard a minister make this statement. You must keep the commandments. You must live by the commandments if you hope to go to heaven. Then he began to enumerate the commandments. Now, a precious person wrote to me not so long ago, and I love them. I've never seen them. But I would do anything in the world I could to help them, and I would be a friend to them. But I cannot compromise the word of God. They said, preacher, we cannot see your religion. Well, in the first place, I don't have any religion. You say, Brother Green, what do you mean? I mean exactly what I said. I don't have religion. I'm a Christian. I'm a believer. I'm not religious. I'm saved. Now, you know, when people do not get drunk and wallow in the mire and murder, they classify them as being religious. He's a religious fellow. You can be a religious fellow and be lost. Judas Iscariot was religious. And I could name some others that were religious in Bible times. Well, for instance, Nicodemus, until he was born again, he was very religious. And of course, Cornelius was a man that feared God. He was very religious. But Peter went over and told him how to be saved. Now, I'm saying that to say this. I don't have religion and I don't want religion. I'm a Christian. I'm a believer. I'm not holier than thou. My sufficiency is in God. Jesus is my salvation. And nothing in me is good except redemption, the shed blood, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. So, now, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. Now, this verse cannot be done away with. It cannot be ignored. It cannot be modified or changed. It is very scripture. And you can't do a thing with it. Romans 10:4. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. The law was a shadow of the good things to come. The law never saved anyone. The law could not save anyone. The law never could have saved anyone. Romans 3:20. By the deeds of the law there should be no flesh justified. law is holy, but the very fact that God's law is holy and pure is the fact that it cannot save us. Now, what do I mean? It was not the holy, sinless life of Jesus that saved us. It was his sacrificial death, his substitutionary death. He took our place. He was our substitute. In other words, it was not the holiness of Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus, the purity of Jesus that saves us. It was his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension. And he sits to mediate and to confess us to the Heavenly Father. So the law is holy, but through the weakness of the flesh, what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, not the law, but the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that we might be made the righteousness of the law in Jesus, in Christ. Now, who also hath made us able ministers. God made us ministers of the New Testament. The New Testament, not the letter. Thou shalt not do this, and thou shalt not do that. And I'm not critical, and I'm not sarcastic. God forbid that I be sarcastic. God forbid that I be ugly. But dear people, draw up resolutions. Our members cannot drink beer. Our members cannot play poker. Our members cannot dance. Get them saved. Get them born again. They won't drink beer. Get them born again. They won't play poker. Get them born again. They won't get drunk. Get them saved. They'll go to church. In other words, draw up a resolution. If you miss 3 Sundays, you are automatically excommunicated. Or if you miss 3 services, you're automatically, we automatically withdraw fellowship. You don't need that. If they're born again, they'll be there unless they're sick or providentially hindered. And if you make them sign a pledge or draw up a rule, that's not going to make them come to church. We go to church, we read the Bible, we pray, we serve God, we live for Jesus because we have the love of God in our hearts, not drawn up in resolution. The letter killeth. The letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. The law of life. Let me read it. It's in Romans 8. I think it'll be well worth our time to read this tremendous chapter. Not all of it, of course, but part of it. There is therefore now no condemnation of them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life, see, the law of the Spirit of life hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. The carnal mind is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. We'll read that in this epistle we're studying now. The law of the Spirit of life. The law of the Spirit of life. In Christ Jesus hath made me free, hath made, not is making or will make, but hath made already, past tense, hath made. Now Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. And so Paul is saying that God, who is our sufficiency, the same God enabled us, putting us in the ministry, to preach the New Testament, not the letter, but the Spirit. Now, if the ministration of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. See, now that doesn't mean that God destroyed the law. Never. God's law will never be destroyed. God's law will never be annihilated. It is annulled. Christ is the end of it. He fulfilled it. He filled it full, and he satisfied God's heart concerning the law. And in Jesus we have life through the Spirit, not the letter, not the law, but through his death, burial, and resurrection. The hub of the wheel of salvation is Jesus. The heart of salvation is Jesus. The breath of salvation is Jesus. The essence of salvation is Jesus. Why not just say it like this? Salvation is Jesus. Not something, but Jesus. Not a program, but Jesus. Not a law, but Jesus. Jesus in you is salvation. Now, the law has been annulled, not destroyed. No. Think not that I've come to destroy the law. Matthew 5:17. Think not that I've come to destroy the law. I have not come to destroy, but to fulfill. And Jesus is the fulfillment of the law. He is the fulfillment of the prophets. All the commandments hang on this. Love the Lord God with all your heart, soul, strength, mind, and your neighbors, yourself, and that's it. All the commandments hang on these two. Love God with all your heart, love your neighbor like you love yourself, and then you fulfill all of them. Christianity is love. God is love. And Jesus was God, and God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? David, this is the most glorious age man has ever known. This is the most glorious age man has ever known. Grace is the best. Nothing better. Grace, God's marvelous grace. For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. Now the Greek word is boldness. We use great boldness or great plainness. Bold means we do not beat around the bush. We do not hesitate. We just dogmatically affirm that this is the most glorious gospel and the most glorious salvation and the most glorious message that man has ever heard or ever known. And we're plain, Paul said. We just preach it plain, and we preach it with force. All right, so the next verse. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded. For until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. You know, I tell you, I never dreamed that there was so much in 2 Corinthians. Oh yes, I've read it, I studied in school, and I've read it and reread it and read it and preached from it. But never verse by verse. This is the first time I've ever gone through 2 Corinthians on the radio, any part of it, verse by verse. Now listen to this. Listen to this tremendous truth wrapped up in these verses. And not as Moses. Paul said, seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness or boldness of speech. Not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. Now watch it. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, behold, as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, carefully. And if there are any, and I know they are because I had a letter, in fact, I had a phone call from a dear Jewish lady. And she said, Brother Green, I listen to you every day. And she said, I appreciate the gospel you preach. If there is a precious Jewish person, man or woman, listening to my voice, read the 53rd of Isaiah. Read Isaiah 53. Read it with an open heart and an open mind. And be with me on the broadcast tomorrow. Read Isaiah 53 with an open heart and an open mind. And be sure and listen in tomorrow. I want to speak tomorrow to all the Jewish friends that will listen in. If you know a person who is Jewish, if you know a Jew, please call them and invite them to tune in. I want to talk about the veil over Moses' face, and I want to read Isaiah 53. Now, what Paul is preaching here to the Corinthians is Jesus Christ, the fullness of the Godhead. He fulfilled every jot and every tittle of the law. He satisfied God's heart as having to do with the law and the prophets. And Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. Will you believe today? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Father, bless the hearts of all who've listened. Stir the hearts of the unsaved. Save the soul that's nearest hell. That poor, precious soul that will not be alive this time tomorrow. Save them, our Father. If they're listening now, save them. Reclaim the backslidden. Dear Lord, God bless every believer and help us to be exceedingly joyous, happy, and thrilled, and help us to praise God that we have Jesus in our hearts. We ask it in his precious name. Amen.
David Green again, and before we close today, I want to mention that I hope you were listening on Monday as we played that wonderful testimony by the dear Gospel Hour listener, and that got us to thinking that we are going to designate September as Special Testimony Month. Now, my dad used to call it Letter Month, and he had people write in special letters of testimony, but this month I want you to either write me your testimony and how the Gospel Hour has helped you in